Good afternoon. I'm Professor Michael Flyer from the Ukrainian Research Institute of Harvard University, and I'm very pleased to serve as today's moderator at our seminar on Ukrainian studies. Today, we're hosting a double header, two speakers with strong ties to our institute who are going to talk about a joint book project on rulers and connectivity in medieval Rus, Europe, and beyond, sort of a Slavic all in the family. Donald Ostrowski is a lecturer in history at the Extension School at Harvard, and Christian Raffensperger is a professor and chair of history at Wittenberg University. Both colleagues are extremely well equipped to tackle the subject at hand. In addition to numerous articles, essays, and reviews on a wide variety of topics in medieval and early modern East Slavic history, politics, social structures, textology, historiography, and religion, Don Ostrowski has also made important contributions to the study of the Mongols and peoples of the Eurasian steppe in their interaction with the Slavs. His book-length monographs include Muscovy and the Mongols, Cross-Cultural Influences on the Steppe Frontier, 1304 to 1589, which was published in 1998, Europe, Byzantium, and the Intellectual Silence of Rus Culture in 2018, and one of my favorite titles, Who Wrote That? Authorship, Controversies from Moses to Sholokhov. You can hardly get broader than that, which came out in 2020. His excellent three-volume edition with co-editor David Birnbaum of the Povest Vremennych Let, an interlinear collation and paradoxes in 2003, published here at HURI, received the Early Slavic Studies Association Award for Distinguished Scholarship. Christian Raffensperger has also ranged widely in medieval studies with an especial interest and mission, I would say, to demonstrate the ways in which medieval Rus was integrated into Europe and not simply the outlier that traditional historiography has portrayed. His book-length monographs include Reimagining Europe, Kievan Rus in the Medieval World, 988 to 1146, published by Harvard University Press and winner of the 2013 Ohio Academy of History Publication Award. Ties of Kinship, Genealogy and Dynastic Marriage in Kievan Rus, was published in 2016 by HURI, with digital components, including a genealogical mapping component in our Institute MAPA project. And in 2018, he published Conflict, Bargaining, and Kinship Networks in Medieval Eastern Europe. He's also worked as co-editor with Frank Sisson and Robert Romanchuk on volumes of the Hrushevsky History of Ukraine Rus Translation Project. In today's seminar, we dig more deeply into the world of East Slavic rulership to hear about this new co-authored book project with the Reaction Publishers in London entitled The Ruling Families of Rus. So I turn the floor over to Christian.
Thank you very much, Michael. I appreciate it. Here, let me share my screen for the PowerPoint here. So we're talking about The Ruling Families of Rus, which is a book project that, as you mentioned, originated with Reaction Press reaching out. They have a new series on dynasties, and they were thinking something along the lines of the Rurikid dynasty to talk about Russian history. And the initial reaction from this side was, well, we don't want to do a project on Russian history. And actually, we don't believe in dynasties. So it might be difficult to participate in a project on dynasties. But they were very flexible in allowing us to be flexible with the definition of what that is. And so I think that actually might be a good place to start, because dynasties, as Don has written about, are often early modern or modern conceits, ways to organize people in the past to try and support those early modern or modern descendants of them. And so the Rurikids is a perfect example for us, but you could do the same with the Piasts and talk about how this is a term that isn't used until the early modern period and is read back into the past. So instead, we wanted to talk about clans and families. This is something that I did in my conflict bargaining book too, also drawing on the work of Don as well. And what I did there was look at a chart like this. So Yaroslav, this would be Yaroslav Volodymyrovich, right? He is of the Volodymyrovichi clan. But then we see his sons, Izyaslav, Sviatoslav, and Vsyevolod. Each of them are still part of the Volodymyrovichi clan, right? But they each then begin to embody their own family, the Izyaslavichi, the Sviatoslavichi, and the Vsyevolodovichi. We see then that this continues through time, and we already see in that next generation, the grandchildren of Yaroslav, that there are potential problems with our terminology in our clans and families. So for instance, is Vladimir Monomakh a member of the Vsyevolodovichi family? Yes. Is he the progenitor of his own Monomakhovichi family? Yes, he might be that as well. And where do we draw the line between the creation of families into clans? And so part of what Don and I wanted to do today in our talk was to be able to share those open questions with you, right, that we are trying to work through. This is certainly one of them. And, you know, another one is, of course, what you might notice on this chart is that this is entirely male dominated. And this is certainly a problem with the concept of dynasty in general, is that it elides identities. So Izyaslav, for instance, on your chart, is a member of the Volodymyrovichi clan. He's the pater familias of the Izyaslavichi. But it doesn't take into account any of the agency of his wife, Gertrude, in raising their children or passing on any of her own cultural package, right, in any fashion. So how do we deal with those sorts of things? That's particularly difficult, and it's something we're trying to work with in each chapter, as I'll try and show you as I walk through some of our plans for the chapters. Another thing that we really wanted to do in this project was not tell a straight line Russian history story, of course. We also didn't want to tell a straight line Ukrainian history story, but we wanted to work within these families and clans and see where they took us. And so we basically looked around for interesting people, right? Who are the interesting people whose stories we want to tell? Who are the heads of their own families, who have particularly interesting connections, who have engagements or battles. So we chose about 12 individuals, and then we made them the center, the focus of our study. And as I said, in regards to our clan and family, we wanted to try and keep the focus not just on another story of great men, but we wanted to include women as well to really provide a fully fleshed out story of all of the things that are going on at this particular time. What this gives us is a table of contents that looks like this, and there's a second one. And what I'd like to do for the next few minutes is just kind of talk through a little bit about what we're doing in the grand project, right? Maybe that's grandiose to call it the grand project, but in the larger project is what I mean. Before I then narrow in and talk just about chapter five. And chapter five is one that I'm working on now. Don then is going to talk to about one of the chapters he's working on, and hopefully that'll help tie all of this together. So we're going to introduce the problem with dynasty, what I've been talking to you about already. We'll provide a little bit of an overview of the Kingdom of Rus. I think if I just keep saying Kingdom of Rus in writing, eventually it will become a more common term. So I'm just going to keep working that out there. So eventually it'll get into Google's top things. Then we're going to talk about rule and succession among the Volodymyrovichi. And this is a topic that, of course, I think Don hates it when I say this, but much ink has been spilled upon this topic. But maybe that's just because he has spilled some of that ink. But chapter two is really going to deal with what it means to succeed in power in Rus in this period. And so you know, Don has a very, very good article about this topic, and we're going to try and distill that for this audience and talk about the argument to be made for succession and between these families and clans. And I'm going to leave that there because I think Don's going to talk about some of the independent knyazhestvos, and so that'll maybe allow us to talk more about how that spreads. We get into the first model of our, what I would consider to be our base template with chapter three, where we talk about Yaroslav the Wise and his family. And so this is what I mean by focusing on interesting individuals, their lives, and what was going on. And of course, as many of you know, Yaroslav is married to Ingegerd, a Swedish princess. They host multiple foreign rulers in Rus. Their children marry royalty from throughout medieval Europe. And so this is not really just a Rusian or a Volodymyrovich family, but a family enmeshed in medieval Europe. And so I thought this was a really good way to start out the book, was with that greater interconnectivity. We already see that beginning to shift a little bit with our next case, which is Mstislav Harold Volodymyrovich. And of course, this is the son of Vladimir Monomakh. And he, like other medieval rulers, had two names. Monomakh, of course, his father being one of them. He was Mstislav in Rus, and of course, he had a Christian name, Fyodor. But he also appears as Harold in the Scandinavian sources because of his paternal, his maternal grandfather, Harold Godwinson, the last Anglo-Saxon king of England. He himself, Mstislav, marries another Scandinavian princess, Kristen Inga's daughter. He subsequently marries the daughter of a mayor of Novgorod, which I think is really interesting. It's one of the few non-noble marriages or non-royal marriages that we see in this period, so that's worth spending some time about. We also see a lot of interconnectivity with the rest of medieval Europe, again, though we're beginning to see a turning point. And that turning point comes in chapter 5 and chapter 6. And so this is where we begin to see the families and the clans kind of go in two different geographical directions. The Sievelet, who is traditionally nicknamed Big Nest, is the ruler of Vladimir Suzdal. And this is the area, an area that is one of the newer regions, although we, of course, are going to challenge that a little bit too. We're going to talk about Yuri, the father. We're going to talk about Andrei Bogolyubsky, his brother. And then we're going to talk about the Sievelet's own marriages. And I'll get into more of this as this is my particular case study. At the same time, chapter 6 moves us in a different direction and allows us to talk about Roman Mstislavich, because he's a contemporary of the Sievelet Big Nest, and he's considered as, in many ways, at least the founder of Galicia Volhynia. And so we've got what's going on the Volga Akha Mesopotamia, I know as Richard Helly used to call it, right? And then we've got what's going on in Galicia Volhynia at the same time. So this is part of the breadth of Rus that we wanted to be talking about. Roman's world is one that involves negotiations with other members of the Volodymyrovichi, talking about succession for Kiev, intervention in Polish conflicts, negotiations with the Hungarians and the Byzantines. And in fact, the Galician Volhynian Chronicle calls him Autocrat of All Rus. So this is a title that we can address a little bit as well. So he and his family are an important one to talk about the breadth of Rus. In chapter 7, we get to another familiar character of Alexander Nevsky. And after the Mongols conquer Rus and Batu establishes the headquarters of the Ulus of Jolchi in the Western Steppe, we see him grant rulership to Yaroslav Sievodovich and then to Alexander Yaroslavich. We see conflict with Alexander's younger brother, Andrei. And this is part of the example of what Don is going to be unpacking in his particular talk today. So I'm going to leave that there as well. But again, this is another attempt to deal with a familiar history in perhaps a slightly unfamiliar way. From there, we move to Yuri Danilovich. He's the grandson, of course, of Alexander Nevsky, and he's one of the first distinguished rulers of Moscow. He went in 1315 to Sarai to get the favor of Khan Uzbek, and he married the Khan's daughter, Kanshaka. And he's the first ruler of Moscow to get the Yarlik, the patent from the Mongols to collect taxes. His son Ivan, Kalita, Moneybags, is the one who cements Moscow's power with his continuing tax collection. And we also see with Yuri Danilovich, we see a kind of shortening of ties. And so our earlier chapters dealt with the broader connections with medieval Europe. We see a little bit of a shortening of that in these later chapters, except when we go west. And so in chapter 9, we talk about Yuri Lvovich. And he and his father Lev were rulers in Galicia, Volhynia in the 14th century. And they too, right, like Roman Mstislavich, engaged in relations with the Tatars, the Hungarians, the Poles, including Yuri's own spouse, the Byzantines, and the attempt to create a new metropolitanate. And then we see the arrival of the Lithuanians, right? So we are working in all different kinds of groups. So this is really what I meant when I said this isn't a story of a straight line Russian history or Ukrainian history. We're really trying to tell a broader story of what's going on in Western Eurasia through these families and clans. Chapter 10 is one I'm really looking forward to. And that is one, it's the only one of it with a female protagonist, Uliana Alexandrovna. And women, of course, are integral to the creation of these families. And when I talk about chapter 5 in particular, we will see that. But Uliana is the daughter of the ruler of Tver. She's the granddaughter of Yuri Lvovich. And she is going to kind of combine these two families together and then also be the mother of Jogaila, right, who inherits the rule in Lithuania, eventually taking Poland as well. She is the dowager who makes a lot of these marital arrangements. In traditional dynasty language, this is all Algirdas, right, her husband, right? But we're going to try and shift the focus and we're going to talk a little bit, not about Algirdas, but we're going to talk about Uliana. Chapter 11 brings us back to Vasily Dmitrievich, son of Dmitry Donskoy, and he rules at a pivotal point with the Moscow submission to Toktamish in exchange for a patent of rule. We're also going to see the marriage to Sofia get a tie with the Lithuanians, the daughter of Vitautas. This is a time of rising prosperity in the Northeast in artistic and technological advances. And of course, then we will also see a return to Byzantine connections. Our final substantive chapter is about Ivan III Vasilievich. And this is going to be a chapter that kind of brings together the end of the story of the Mongols with our story of these clans and families. It's very involved and it's going to talk about how his son Ivan is going to change a lot of the organizational structure of Muscovy. He's going to invite in Italian architects and engineers. His second marriage, of course, is to Zoe, Sofia Pilyalogina. So we're going to see a little bit of a return or an opening up of some of those connections at the end of our story. So maybe a bit involved, but I wanted to walk you through kind of this overview of what it is the book is going to be covering before I talk about my specific example from today, which is a chapter on Vsevolod Yurevich. Now, each of the chapters has a similar structure. It starts with an overview of the region and kind of the how we get to our particular main character, Vsevolod in this case. So I talk about Yuri, talk about Andrei Bogolubsky and how Vsevolod came to power. Next, the next section talks about the main character and his wife, because they are, of course, the center of that family. So Vsevolod Yurevich and his wives. And here is an example I'd like to use, at least briefly, of how it is we're trying to challenge what's often considered to be common knowledge. I mean, if you open many of the books on the history of this period, you see something about Vsevolod's Ossetian wife, right? His wife from the Caucasus, Maria Shvarnova. But in reality, we don't really know who she is. Fyodor Uspensky and Anna Litvina have spent a lot of time trying to figure this out. But they're pretty sure that it's not Ossetian or Czech, right, which is another of the older possibilities here. So we're trying to put all of that into practice. And one of the maxims that Don has pushed from the beginning of this project that I've wholeheartedly adopted, and I've even quoted in some of my other stuff now, is the idea that we should be teaching accurate history to people no matter the level. We shouldn't try and teach undergrads or general audiences, you know, one thing and then say, well, you'll get the real truth, right, when you get to the graduate study. So we're trying to really load those questions into the text and say, sometimes we don't know, right? Sometimes we don't know the answer, but here are some of the reasons we think the things that we think. Then we have a section in the chapter about what's going on in that particular region at that time. So for instance, now, of course, it's a momentous time under Vsevolod Yurevich because we see Mongols and Crusaders, architectural developments and church building. That same Maria Vasyevolod's wife contributes to the growth of this process. She founds a monastery in 1200 dedicated to the Bogorodica. This monastery is founded with great fanfare. It comes to be known in Vladimir Suzdal as an associated monastery with the family. Already in 1201, Yevgenia, a sister of Maria's, is buried there. In 1205, Vasyevolod and Maria's daughter Yelena is buried there. Maria herself takes holy orders and is buried there after her own death. And so this is a monastery that becomes the Kinyevgeny Monastery. And in fact, Talia Zayats, who I know is on the call today, has written about this monastery a little bit as well. And in keeping with my own work, I'm going to call it the Queen's Monastery, as the Kinyevgeny Monastery. Then we talk about the children in the family. And so we'll talk about Vasyevolod Yurovich and Maria's children, because it appears that all of the children are Maria's rather than coming from his second wife. And so, you know, those of you who know me know I could never participate in any book that didn't have a genealogical table. So we have genealogical tables for all of these people. We've got here the various marriages and then selected children. And so I'm just going to talk about a couple of them. But Constantine, of course, is the eldest, but he's an interesting case for us because he doesn't immediately inherit after Vasyevolod's death. And in fact, there are chronicle sources that tell us that Vasyevolod had disinherited Constantine because Vasyevolod on his deathbed called to Constantine to come to him and Constantine refused. Again, this story too is contested. And so we're trying to tell that story as to what happened, or at least what the sources tell us, right? So this is a phrase that crops up a lot, is these particular sources tell us these particular things. And they include the fact that in 1216, Constantine goes to war with his own brothers, Yuri and Yaroslav, to try and take the throne. Right? And it works. Constantine rules for 2 years, 1216 to 1218, before he dies. The other story I wanted to tell you from the family is about Verkhoslava. And we know so much more about the sons of Vasyevolod and Maria than we do about the daughters, as is pretty common for our source base. But Verkhoslava is an interesting case because in 1189, she marries Rostislav Rurikovich, Rurik being the ruler of Kiev at the time. Now, typically, that's as laconic as the source gets. It's like, that's it. The marriage was made. But Hypatian tells us a much more involved story, and it begins with a procession in which Rurik, Rostislav's father and the ruler of Kiev, sends his brother-in-law Gleb, Gleb's wife, multiple boyars, and their wives to Suzdal to meet Vyacheslava and bring her to her new husband, Rostislav. Upon their arrival in Vladimir Suzdal, Vasyevolod greets them and then gave his daughter to them to take away. But first, he bestowed upon her numerous gifts, including a great deal of gold and silver, as well as bestowing gifts upon Rurik's party. Perhaps the most touching part of this story is the human element. Quote, he, Vasyevolod, followed his dear daughter as far as 3 days' march from home, and the father and mother wept for her because she was dear to them and young, being 8 years old, end quote. Now, it's fascinating to the historian to know that he gave his daughter gifts, gold and silver, but for the parent, right, it's an astonishing detail to hear about how both Vasyevolod and Maria followed after for 3 days because they loved the young daughter and would miss her. And we don't get a lot of details like that in our sources, especially in Rus. Verkhoslava's story doesn't end there, though, right? She arrives, actually, in Belgorod. She's married in May 8th in the Church of the Holy Apostles, and the chronicle tells us it's the greatest wedding that had been held in Rus at that time. There were 20 knyazya in attendance, which, of course, is interesting. It tells us all about rulership in Rus, but also it tells us that after the wedding, Rurik bestowed gifts on his new daughter-in-law, many gifts, and, in fact, a city, the city of Bragin. Further evidence for women being able to own and possess goods, even towns. And Rurik sent messages and messengers to Vasyevolod to say that she arrived, that the wedding had happened, and of course to exchange more gifts. So this is something that gives us all kinds of information packed in here. And it's these kinds of stories that we want to include to talk about the multifaceted nature of these clans and families. And these are stories that, of course, include women and have to include women in our story. And so then each chapter ends with a little conclusion, wrapping up and ideally segueing into the next. And so even though our next chapter would be 6, I'm going to segue into Don, who's going to talk about chapter 7.
Okay, so we go over here and we do start. Okay, so thanks, Chris. That was excellent. And since he quoted me, I'm going to quote him. One of the things that Chris points out about the problem with dynasty is that it's neat and tidy. There are no dead ends. It's all teleological. And so all the details get lost. Whereas with families and clans, it's pretty messy. And there are lots of dead ends and that tend to be overlooked in the general, generally accepted narrative. And I think both of us come to this project really dissatisfied with the conventional wisdom, as it were. The other issue is the problem of terminology, which we're working out as we go along, and you may see some examples of our still working these things out. So I just wanted to make 3 points quickly. The independent Kanyashis falls that Chris mentioned, Nevsky's cooperation with the Mongols, which is an ongoing issue, whether one knows it or not, and then the role of the Mongols in overruling the collateral system of succession. So between the 12th and 13th century, the succession process, won't use the term system, devolved into 4 ruling clans. And I liking to a hole in a donut, where these clans in their provincial capitals are the donut, and they pop in one of their individuals into Q to rule for a time, so that it can then be passed on to their descendants. Because if they don't rule in Q, then they get excluded. Their descendants get excluded. So I've color coded the 4 clans at this time. There could be different names for them. Other people sometimes call them differently. This is for our purposes. And I'll talk about genealogical charts. Okay, this is kind of not clear, but if you put in these lines, and so the green line goes back to Oleg, so the Ogovichi, the blue line goes back eventually to Volodymyr Monomakh, but through Izyaslav, so Izyaslavichi, and same with the yellow line going back through Rostislav to Volodymyr, so it's Rostislavichi. And the green line, I don't have Vsevolod on it, but it's the Vsevolod Vichy. So to give you an example of how this worked in practice, so here are the rulers of Kiev in 1235 to 1240. You have a succession of rulers, 6 different rulers, 2 from the Rostislavichi, 2 from the Olgovichi, 1 from the Sevolodovichi, and then 1 from Daniil, who didn't even occupy Kiev at the time, and appointed a governor. But why were they doing this? Well, so that they could ensure that their sons, the next generation, would have legitimacy to claim to be the ruler. Otherwise, if your father didn't rule in a town, and the formula was, my father and my grandfather ruled, therefore I have legitimacy to rule. If your father didn't rule, then you have no legitimacy to rule. There are some exceptions, but you have to get agreement among the other kanyasi. So this is a map of going to the independent Knyazhes was so Kyiv, Pereyaslavl, Chernihiv, Ryazan, Vladimir in the north, Smolensk, Polotsk, Novgorod, Turov, and Halych and Volhynia. Now, one of the interesting things, maps always show, when they show Vladimir Suzdal, Knyazhe's fall, they show Rostov as part of it, but it wasn't quite that simple, as I'll point out. So just at random, took some of the more important of these, call them independent, in quotation marks. So Kyiv became rather symbolic. It was abandoned as a residence for rulers after about 1240. Andrei Bogolyubsky tried that earlier in the early 12th or mid 12th century, but it was still important. Ryazan, Stevolod got very upset with them because they had been associated with the Olgovichi, but Vsevolod wanted to take over Ryazan, and the Ryazan Knyazi kept playing a back and forth game. So he finally said, okay, people of Ryazan, pack up your bags, you're out of here. And he burned the city. And where did the people go? He took them to Suzdal line, where he had them populate the settlements there in Suzdal. Now that all of this occurs some 29 years before the Mongol sack, and I wonder, well, how much was left in 1237 for the Mongols to sack? But you have the destruction of the Ryazan land. Turov. This is an interesting story we can't get into right now. Izyaslav Davidovich besieges the city in 1158 unsuccessfully. Why? He's concerned because Yuri Dolgoruki appointed his son to be Knyaz of Turov and thought Yuri Dolgoruki, you know, from Vladimir Suzdal, was trying to expand into a previously independent town and area. It didn't work. Eventually, Turov got taken over by the Lithuanians. Pereyaslavl, under control of the Olgovichi, but sacked by the Mongols in 1239. Polotsk remained independent under Brachislavichi until 1240. And in many cases, the practice of succession was one of primogeniture, not collateral succession in these towns. Novgorod, the Vsevolodovichi take over, pretty much assume control during the 13th century, and I think I can show you why. And Rostov remained independent within Vladimir Suzdal area under the descendants of Konstantin Vsevolodovich. And Chris mentioned Konstantin, and he, after he died, he took over Vladimir, but then died, and Yuri came back. But his descendants were in charge of Rostov, and they operated pretty much independently of the Knyazi and Vladimir, as far as we can tell. One other thing I wanted to point out was the lateral succession within among brothers. So you see, from Andrei Bogolyubsky, from the time Andrei ascends to the throne to Vsevolod dies, it's 55 years. That effectively excludes any cousins from taking over, because in the meantime, they've pretty much all died off. The next generation, similarly, from 1212, when Yuri took over, to 1248, another 36 years. Andre Yaroslavich takes over in 1249, and then until 1277, it's another 28 years. So this tends to have a centripetal effect in consolidating rulership within a particular family. But sometimes happens, you get splits. So in the next generation, from 1277 to 1304 is 27 years, and then it switches to the cousin Mikhail Yaroslavich. He's not a descendant of Alexander, he's a descendant of Alexander's brother. He rules for 14 years and was given the Yaroslavich by the Khan. But when he is executed, Yuri is given the Yaroslavich, but Yuri, as you see, should not have been, according to the Rus system of succession, because his father never ruled, Daniil. It goes back to the Tver Yaroslavichi for a while, but then eventually the Danilovichi take over, and I'll come back to that. I'll circle back to that in a second because it's rather important. The issue of Alexander Nevsky, this to me at the beginning of the film, Eisenstein's film Alexander Nevsky is a dialogue that is very interesting. An old man talks to Alexander. It's just after Alexander has encountered the Buskok, the Tatar Buskok. The Mongols are a hard-necked people, a strong people. It won't be easy fighting them. And Alexander says, "Is there a will for the fight?" And the old man, "It's time to avenge the deaths of our forefathers," now, which is very interesting because the invasion occurred 5 years earlier. So how four could the fathers be? And Alexander says, "The Mongols can wait a while. We have a more dangerous enemy, an enemy who is closer and crueler. After we beat them, then we will take care of the Mongols." And Eisenstein did plan a sequel to Alexander Nevsky in which the Rus beat the Mongols. And the old man says, "Let it be the Germans then. You know where to start, but our patience is at its end, Kinaz." And this is the question. Why is Alexander fighting the Germans, Livonian Knights, but not the Mongols? Why is he cooperating with the Mongols? Especially after World War II, there were a number of historians like Fennell who were ready to accuse Nevsky of some kind of being a collaborationist. And what they had in mind, I think, was Marshal Pétain in France, Vichy France, who the Germans occupied the country and he cooperated. It seemed very similar to what Alexander had done under the Mongols. His brother, Alexander's brother, Andre, is recorded in the chronicles as that after he had been appointed to be Kinaz of Vladimirsip, I can't deal with the Mongols anymore. I'm out of here. And he flees to Sweden. But eventually he comes back and he too deals with Mongols. So yeah, in one sense, it's anachronistic. It's two different time periods, two different scenarios. But this is a central question. Alexander Nevsky, the great hero of Russian history, there are all sorts of awards and monasteries and prospects named after him. And there's some questions here. So that's one point for discussion. So I'll just wrap up very quickly so we have time for discussion here. Basically, I see the same process going on before 1240 is after 1240, but a different outcome. So centripetal versus centrifugal, we can keep them straight. So that same process that led to decentralization of the ruling clans into cousin groups before 1240, those four clan ruling clans, also led to, and I call it undecentralization because I'm trying to avoid the term centralization. It's not really centralization as such, maybe consolidation is a better term after 1240. So there was this conflict between cousin groups, between the Yaroslavichi of Tver and the Danilovichi of Moscow, which threatened to decentralize things within the Northeast. The Mongol Tatar Khan, Uzbek, ultimately chose the Danilovichi over the Yaroslavichi. But it was the succession war of the 15th century that pretty much sealed the deal. And what was the deal? A new system of succession. Instead of collateral succession, it now was primogeniture. Vasily fought the war against his uncle, Yuri, and his cousins, Dmitry Chemyaka and Vasily Kosoy, in order to establish that principle, and it was confirmed by Uluk Mehmed, the Khan of the Orda. The story gets more complicated than that, but for now we'll leave that. And then when Vasily II died, then his son took over, and so on. This is a very different situation from what had occurred by the middle of the 13th century. But how these two outcomes, how they evolved out of the same process, is part of the interesting, but I think is interesting story that we're trying to explore. And that's all for now.
Okay, thank you very much. And so why don't I perhaps just open the floor and take some questions. Does anyone have some? I know I see some people here who have lots at stake that wanted to get their opinions in. So let's start with Talia Zayats.
Hello, everybody. Okay, it's exciting to get to ask the first question. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing your book project and for the fascinating presentation. I found it very convincing and appreciate your time. I have so many questions, so I'll try to maybe limit myself to two, if I can, really quickly related questions. One is, the vexed question of terminology, which I know you're trying to determine what is the most sort of appropriate terminology. And I was wondering about Father Dimnik, who passed away this past year, his idea of houses, and whether that was something that you had considered different houses rather than clans, or what you thought of that idea. And then I also was thinking about family emblems, when we talk about Scottish clans, there is a kind of pre-heraldic or sort of clan symbolism like tartans. Do we have any kind of visual evidence of emblems being used as clan signs or as reinforcing clan or family identity? And I was thinking, for example, of the Königsberg Chronicle, where I think there's an example of a lion drawn by, I think it's Yuri Dolgoruki. And sometimes the lion is also associated, I think, with Danilo Romanovich. So are there any examples in, I don't know, coinage or in the visual sources that you showed of perhaps family emblems reinforcing this idea of cousin groups? But anyway, thank you very much.
Okay.
You want to talk about houses?
Or Don?
We did discuss houses and we decided not to use it. The terminology is in kind of imprecise, and for our purposes, we're trying to be as precise as possible. And how seems kind of a kind of a general term that so we don't really have to deal with. Are we talking a family? Are we talking a clan? At what point does it evolve from one clan to another? If you just talk house, then that brushes all of those questions under the carpet. And we don't want to brush any questions under the carpet. I don't know about
some questions I do want to brush under the carpet, but not that one.
Okay, so the emblems we want to brush under the carpet.
Yeah, emblems I want to brush under the carpet. I feel like that is something we don't have nearly enough evidence to say that there are emblems that mean this family or not that family. I mean, even when we look at the earliest coins and seals, there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of consistency over time. I mean, you've got the Burekid Trident, but then you've also got the little cross edition, or then you've got these other editions, and people have made arguments that that means a different family. Or a different person, individual. In my own work, and I know, Talia, you have delved into all of the material culture sources for the 11th and 12th century in Rus. I mean, I can't think of enough data points that would give us evidence for that.
Okay, thanks very much.
Yeah.
Okay. Frank.
Could you give us a little more discussion of how you view this word of dynasty and clans on the western borderlands with Galicia, Volhynia, how it relates to the Algirdovici, or do we do away with Gediminids? Is there an intermixing with what we used to call the Piast, which I guess you're warning us not to use as a dynasty? And does it then develop in a different way than the way that Dom does? Described obviously for the north and east. So anything you can do on that one.
I think Fawad can start. Don, please jump in. But I think clan and family gives us a lot more flexibility on the western border than we do have with dynasty. So for instance, we could talk about Roman Mstislavich, and then we could talk about Yuri Lvovich, and we don't have to be talking about dynasties, right? We could talk about each of them as centers of their own family. Similarly, instead of saying someone marries into the Piast, or in my conflict bargaining book, I call them the Mishkovici. If somebody marries into them, they don't immediately just become subsumed under that label. Similarly, with the Gediminids, we can talk about this, I think, and this is one of our truisms, much more specifically by breaking apart some of those larger categories. And similar with Don's answer to house, right? We're trying to get at the specifics a lot more.
Okay.
Oh, the only Don, did you want to add to that?
Yeah. By the way, I'll just mention it because I came up the at this point, the volume 2 of Hrushevsky that Chris did so much work on as the editor is at the printer and will be out on the 16th of April. So I just wanted to add that to his list of publications.
Excellent.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
I use it then to write my chapter about chapter 6.
Yeah. I have another number of questions waiting, but I just want to make sure. Harvey Goldblatt has said I have a comment. Is it on this specific topic or is it simply another question?
I have a comment in regard to Alexander Nevsky and the question.
Okay.
Very briefly. As regards to the point that Don made, I think what is striking about both the textual tradition of Alexander Nevsky and up to Eisenstein's film is the extent to which the Western threat is at the forefront. And this has, in my view, a great deal to do with certain developments after the Fourth Crusade and the taking of the City of God by the Westerners, and the lingering effects of that, and the visits of various people to the southern lands from Rus. So I'd leave that there. The question I have is, How difficult has it been in discussing someone like Sevolod, the big nest, within?
Yeah, we've lost you.
Of the seams in the Laurentian Chronicle in the late 13, in regard to the late 1170s and through the 1180s up to 1187 or 8.
Yeah, there are a lot of gaps in that story. And, you know, I mean, we can say that he went to Byzantium. And in fact, Don and I are writing chapters and passing them back and forth, as you might imagine, in a co-written thing. And this is one of those pieces that I said, you know, they were exiled to Byzantium. And Don and I had a dialogue about how, well, they may have been kicked out, but they weren't exiled to Byzantium. They made a conscious choice to go to Byzantium, or at least that's what the sources allow us to say. But because of also the nature of the book, while we are trying to be specific and detail oriented, we also don't feel, and Don, correct me if you feel differently, that we have to cover all of the bits and pieces. So for instance, on Don's genealogy showed you Mikhail rules between Andrei and Vsyevolod, he doesn't even get a mention in the chapter on Vsyevolod. I talk about Yuri, I talk about Andrei, and then straight into Vsyevolod because there's only so much time.
Yeah, and on Alexander, we had a discussion about, Chris and I, on the Pope, Innocent IV, was convinced that Alexander's father, Yaroslav, had converted to Catholicism, or at least was willing to recognize the primacy of the Pope, and claims, Innocent claims, that John of Planocarpini told him that, who was there in Karakorum when Yaroslav was there, and Yaroslav died shortly afterwards, so Yaroslav couldn't say, no, I didn't, or confirm. And then, Innocent wrote a letter to Alexander, Yaroslav's son, and says, thanking him for his willingness to convert to Catholicism. And the question was, well, what's going on here? Did they really convert? What, is Innocent making this up? Is he convinced that they have converted? Are people telling him something different? Kind of different from the narrative that Alexander was the staunch opponent of the Crusaders coming in and taking over the land. Well, is Alexander playing a double game?
On the other hand,
with the papacy.
On the other hand, in the textual tradition of Alexander Nevsky, you do have the doctrinal disputes between the papacy and their authorities and Alexander Nevsky. And of course, the winner without any doubt is Alexander Nevsky.
Yeah. And we, what we decided, we wanted to red flag these issues. We didn't want to pretend they don't exist as we tend to, we feel that the traditional narratives say, well, no one really needs to know about that. I think people need to know there's some question there.
Okay, how about Danilo Lishishin?
Thank you very much for this opportunity. My question is, in regards to on that theme of the church, we've been discussing how the competition between the different clans affected a church policy in Rus, such as, for example, the election of Clement Smolyatinich in 1147, and then the subsequent heavy competition between the Archbishop of Novgorod and the bishops of Zalesia, and then the bishops of Kyiv and in the other cities?
Sadly, no, at least not to the specific Klim Smolyatych example, because it seems to fall in the cracks of some of the things that we're focusing on. In the Yaroslav chapter, of course, I talk about Illyrion, and then later on, we will absolutely get into more ecclesiastical issues, for instance, when there are split metropolitans or attempts to split the metropolitanate and create other archbishoprics. So the broader answer to your big question is yes, we will deal with attempts by different clans to claim ecclesiastical power for themselves. But in reference to Klim Smolyatych specifically, no, unfortunately, we're not going to talk about him.
Yeah, and the book is not intended to be an exhaustive survey. We're not trying to do Khrushchevsky or anything. We want to hit certain high points and present a different perspective. It's covering a lot of centuries. And I think the way Chris outlined the book with the various chapters really allows us to get to a number of important issues, a number of important questions, but not all of them. But we'll leave it for someone else to do the rest. How's that?
Thank you. Have lots of pictures, though, which is new for me at least.
Yeah. Let me just break in here for a minute to ask a question. You actually stated as your criterion for deciding what to talk about, these would be interesting individuals. Of course, I'm interested in your definition of interesting. But when we get to, for instance, Vsevolod, greatness on the one hand, and it seems as though Andrei Bogolyubsky, because he's, of course, his brother, is kind of a side note, and yet from the point of view of interest and the breadth of the things that Andrei is involved in, how did you decide on that particular one to choose Vsevolod over Andrei?
Hey, Don, I should have expected this question from Michael. Michael, we did cite your articles on Andrei. I just wanted to let you know we did. Mm-hmm. For interest's sake, you're absolutely right. However, I thought that for Vsevolod, a case could be made, and Don made a similar case for one of the Muscovite rulers, that it might be more interesting to take to cover some newer ground, some different ground with Vsevolod, whereas in the story of Vsevolod, we could talk about Andrei. And Vsevolod then also is a better example in terms of family, because he sets up a family that then continues, as opposed to Andrei, who doesn't.
Mm-hmm. And the other one had to do with what you're doing with each of these projects over the course of these centuries. Are you, at least even at this point, beginning to tease out any patterns of one way or another in the way that families interact and then lead in one or other direction? Or is it just too early yet?
No, excellent question. That's exactly what I've been trying to explore. And my conclusion was a bit in that direction about how the process is the same, but the outcomes are different. Yes, we are looking for patterns, and I'm sure we will discover more.
Okay. All right. I have a question from Oleksandr Zavalov.
Okay. Thank you so much for this very interesting discussion. I'm just wondering, since Russian family members, ruling family members, married very often with Polovtsi, are there any facts of such marriages, for instance, with Pechenegs or and Torks before Polovtsi?
No, the Polovtsi is the first one we have any records of. Of course, that period when it's just the Pechenegs, let's say pre-1036, is so underrepresented in our source base that things could be there and we don't know enough about them to say. But we do have, of course, examples of Polovtsi marriages beginning already at the end of the 11th century with, the Vsevolodovici in particular.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's see. How about Pete Brown on YouTube? He actually gave me two questions here. One for, well, let me just read it. Do you feel that your and Don's work on genealogy up through chapter 9 will markedly alter our understanding of Kievan Novgorodian history? And then to Don.
Oh, absolutely.
That one was for Christian. And then to Don, do you feel that your four donuts should change past interpretations of the Lubitsch agreement? So Christian, I guess you're first.
Yeah, and I'd rather answer Don's. Maybe that's just the donuts. Yes, I really do think that if not fundamentally altering, I think what we're going to see is, to borrow Don's phrase, we're going to tease out a lot of things that aren't typically talked about. And so this isn't a comprehensive coverage of all of these areas, but I think there are going to be different relationships that'll be highlighted. And so, I mean, just to take one example from the example from what I talked about earlier, Maria Shvarnova, right? It's very common to talk about her in a particular way and talk about ties to the Ossetians and to the Caucasus as part of Vladimir Suzdal's relationship to the east or to the south, right? But if we make her Uspensky and Ludvina have talked about as somebody else, maybe even a Novgorodian, right? That changes our picture. And so by taking things from the specialist literature and introducing them into this larger text directed towards a larger audience, I think that'll shift the broader narrative. And certainly I think that's something Don and I would like, is to include a lot of the really great points that, including so many of you in the audience, have made in specialist literature, and then to expand those into our broader arguments about what's going on.
Yeah, and to Pete's question, which is a very good one, the dynamic changes. So after Yaroslav the Wise dies, and we had a discussion about, well, when was Yaroslav first called the Wise and by whom? The dynamic changes with the movement toward clans in outlying, for want of a better term, provincial capitals, because they have, instead of a rota system where they're each moving up, you know, one city to you, they're maintaining their power base in their capital. But they want to be able to step in to Kyiv to get at least one of each of the, of one in each generation to rule there so that they can continue that. But then when you come down to Bogolubsky, he says, no, I don't feel that I need to go to Kyiv. I can stay here and be the Knyaz. That doesn't quite work out. But the point is, by viewing this history through the dynastic lens, it's all individuals. And you know, this Knyaz followed that Knyaz, and that Knyaz followed this Knyaz, and then you get down. So you go all the way from Volodymyr the Great to Ivan the Third, and it's a straight line, you know, the Stepanaya Kniga line. And what we're seeing in the sources is the primary sources, you know, as far as we can tell, the sources of the time, it's a much more complex situation where there are lots of possibilities, that some that occur, some that don't occur. So we get away from this kind of blinders approach where we're only focusing on the head person and who they pass their power on to next.
Okay. Frank, do you have another comment? Yes.
Maybe to ask for a follow-up, but yeah, I was interested before in to what degree the Algirdis family gets integrated into this or remains separate? I mean, do you see a passing on of this Rus tradition into Lithuania and what becomes the Grand Duchy of Lithuania? And then the second would be the anomaly of Polotsk. Did your study of all of this give us any better feeling of why it behaves so differently, or rulers behave so differently than in the rest of the systems? So for either of you who would like to.
And you want to do the first one or the second one?
It had occurred to me, your question had occurred to me before, and I, there's only so much we can do in this book. It's not that big a book. So I don't, we can signal, the Lithuanian inheritance of Rus, but beyond that, I don't think we can do very much.
Well, I think we'll know more to how much we can signal, for instance, when we get to those chapters, and we're not quite there yet. I mean, Don today was talking about in his piece, Vasilvlad Yurevich's sack of Ryazan. And I mean, I think it is three sentences in chapter five. And it's important because it generally doesn't come up at all apart from the primary sources. We are trying to be conservative. Polotsk similarly doesn't come up very often, but you know, my own ideas is that this is an example of the succession and the Izgoy principle. And we see too early somebody's excluded from Kiev. Now, I've always thought that Polotsk isn't excluded from the Kingdom of Rus, but they are excluded from taking over Kiev until, of course, the usurpation under Izislav Yaroslavich.
But at some point, there has to be real importance. It's only one of the three major cathedrals named after Sofia in Rus to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Well, and Sofia, this is another example too. I mean, Don mentioned the Yaroslav the Wise. So, we keep coming back to these things that everybody knows, and I am a absolute culprit. I will write things that are common knowledge, and then I will get a note from Don like, how do you know that's true? So, Saint Sofia is now a term that I can't use anymore. Yaroslav the Wise, I'm now, footnoting with. Was he really wise? We don't know. Part of this questioning of common knowledge.
And Sophia is not a saint anyway, yes?
Right.
Right.
Let's see, Susanna.
Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you so very much for this wonderful talk. It's wonderful to see you all back in Harvard. As you can see, we are here in sunny Spain. Anyway, one question in relation to what Talia asked before, and also with the discussion on whether we should talk about, or we could talk about houses, families, and dynasties. And I'm sure that occurred to you before, but is there any way that you relate the complex question of naming names with the patrimonial inheritance? I mean, any sort of reflection on whether there are, so many palaces, cathedrals, monasteries built by whom as part of the patrimony of that particular branch or family or dynasty or anything, because it occurred to me when Tanya was saying this, I am supposed to be a member of a clan. There is no sort of place attached to a clan except the chief of the clan. I mean, you can be a member of the clan without having any recognizable physical space. And a house usually you identify with the palace. And I don't know if you have maybe tried to tie this sort of materiality aspect of who had what in order to define this kind of very tricky question. So thank you.
Yeah, so this is an interesting one, and it's not something that I think we're getting into in this text, but it's something that I've looked at for another project that I'm working on. And in your part of the world, of course, there are places like Las Cuevas where you have this as a royal burial center. But even, newer studies of Las Cuevas will point out, and San Isidoro, of course, is similar. San Isidoro, let's talk about that. San Isidoro, by the 13th century, begins to be viewed as a royal center, not as a center for family or maybe even for clan, right? But by the 13th century, we see the recreation of some of these tombs that are connecting it back into the earlier, even 10th century kings. So that's, I would say, an early modern phenomenon or a late medieval phenomenon to try and connect these things back. Now, I've looked at this in Rus as well, and we have, and Dimnik, of course, talked about people founding clan monasteries and then setting up burials there. But when I actually go and look back at the chronicle sources, it seems like this is actually much more of a family deal than a clan deal, because we see individuals roughly every other generation create a new foundation or be buried somewhere else. So even if we extend it to ecclesiastical establishments, we're not seeing a center for a clan.
Yeah, and we had a discussion, Chris and I, it's an ongoing discussion about, well, for example, when Bogolubsky decides to stay in the Redeemer and does some construction projects there, is he trying to shift the center of Rus from Kiev to Vladimir? Or is this a post facto interpretation by the dynasts who say, well, see, we have a shift of power to the northeast. And that ties in, you know, with the whole notion of the mass migration of people from the Dnieper area, you know, they kind of put on their backpacks and they walked. One problem is our sources are very sparse and can be quite ambiguous. On the other hand, there's a well-developed narrative. It's been developed over the last, 150, 200, more than 200 years now, that, okay, as with Yaroslav the Wise, when was Nevsky first called Nevsky? When was Shevalov first called Big Nest? And a lot of this goes to the 19th century nationalists. So why are they doing that? I can see, you know, calling Shevalov Big Nest because there were a lot of Shevalovs. And so it kind of distinguishes him, and a lot of Yaroslavs, so the Wise, that distinguishes him. But what we're trying to disentangle, what this overlayer is that comes later from what the sources are telling us, but the sources are not being all that cooperative in telling us things. We have to kind of tease them out, as Chris says.
And the Yaroslav one is particularly interesting too, because Ingigerd, his wife, is called the Wise in Scandinavian sources, but he's not called the Wise. And so my initial statement was, look, they're both wise. And then Don's like, well, where's your source for where the Yaroslav is called the Wise? So, I mean, one might possibly theorize that Yaroslav gets called the Wise in the 19th century as a way to denigrate Ingigerd or to take the onus of wisdom from her and put it on him. So we can get into patriarchy that way.
Interesting. Other questions? No, everybody's...
We brought you in just on time, Michael.
Yeah, you certainly did. Oh, wait. Yeah, actually, I had a question that I wanted to ask. With all of the great work right now that's being done, well, like people by people like Talia and Alexandra...
Vukovic
in the UK, specifically about women. Has any of that, those new discoveries or new ideas, actually had an interesting influence on the way you're looking at things and trying to find things you didn't see before?
Yeah, absolutely. Gave Talia a shout out. We're talking about Maria Shvarnova. I mean, I learned from her work in the Companion to Medieval Queenship piece that she did. And then, you know, she's written some great stuff that talks about the material culture, for instance, with Anna Yaroslavna and Anastasia Yaroslavna. Those are absolutely things that are working their way into scholarship. into my scholarship at the very least.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Ness as well, the work Ness has done. It's very informative. So yeah, if you've written anything on women in medieval Rus, make sure we know about it because we're looking for it.
Good, good, very good. Okay, seeing no more little golden hands or not receiving anything more on chat, I think it's probably time for us to end, but I want to thank Don and Christian for an extremely interesting presentation and some wonderful questions from all of you.
And thank you very much for coming.
Yes, and I do want to make a little announcement before, and that is that next week, March 31st, same time, same place, we're going to have a lecture by Maria Sanovetsky entitled Sharavashchina, Sonic Contestations of Ukrainian Wildness. You can't miss that. So everyone stay safe, have a good day, and we'll see you next week.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.